I think the first experience I had of the film, I mean, obviously, I've watched it many times and even taught a class at the university when I was there on religion and film. And I used this, you know, I went through different religions and I said, this is the Catholic film. And it was interesting because a lot of people want it, you know, how about the Bells of St. Mary's or something like that, which are all wonderful films, all these things, but they're quite sentimental. And this is the exact opposite of the sentimentality. And I think a lot of people have a sense or an experience of the priesthood through cinema that's not quite accurate. You know, it touches on aspects, but this really shows a man who is passionately in love with Christ and the identity that he has. And it's commented in the middle, in the beginning of the film. He's always wearing his cassock, or I'll call it a soutane as well. And why do you wear that thing, that antiquated thing? Because this is who he is. I have a vocation, he says. And he sees his life completely at service. Kind of reminds me of the Holy Father when he says, you have to smell like your sheep. And he's willing to do that. He just goes and he's with his people all the time. So what struck me about it was that he knows from the very onset of the film that he's going to die. And then he serves his flock. In effect, that's really what the priesthood is, that we know that we are going to die for our people. Hopefully not in the way in which he dies in the film, though he went quick. But sorry, that was a spoiler alert. People haven't seen it. But really what he's doing, it's aptly named. It's named Calvary for a reason. He's living Calvary. And Jesus knew he was going to die. And I think that's something very interesting. In a very small town like that, he most likely in himself knew who the person was that was talking to him in the beginning of the film and threatening him. I imagine he probably recognized people's voices.
Why do you think he doesn't want to go to the police or anything like that?
Well, I mean, it's a good question, right? Because I think he's taking on, what he's doing is he's taking on the sins that caused this man's hurt. And so in effect, he's living the hurt along with him. It would be a terrible catalyst for a story if he just went to the police and it'd be like a 15-minute film. But I think what he's doing is it's showing that what is he? He's a priest. And what does a priest do? He's an alter Christus, another Christ. And Jesus didn't go off and call up an army to help him. Jesus knew who was going to betray him. He predicts it many times in the scriptures. But Jesus also willingly goes to Calvary. He willingly goes to the cross. And that's exactly what Gleason's character is doing, is he's willingly walking with his people, knowing that it's going to lead to his demise. In effect, I mean, that's what a priest does, is he willingly walks with his people, knowing that he's walking away from comfort. I think something that strikes me with this so much is that he doesn't want to abdicate the responsibility, because what happens in the clergy affects us all. Like, in effect, he's taking that priest's sin onto himself, as well as the hurt and pain of the other guy. And that's something that is very clear throughout the abuse scandals as well. We were all, the people who suffered the most outside of the victims, obviously, are the priests who didn't do those things, because we're seen completely differently. And, you know, it's like I've often talked to, you know, I live in the Washington, D.C. metro area, and there's people in the military here all the time. And the ones who get it about that are especially people like the Marines and people who are part of a military cadre. Because if a small group of them go and do something, I remember during the Abu Ghraib prison, scandals and things like that, people started to look and think that every soldier, every Marine was like that. And that happened to us. I mean, I remember when the scandals first broke, I was in the seminary. And of course, that really shook us. And the scandals in Philadelphia, and I was in Boston, I was in the seminary in Philadelphia. So it was like right there. I mean, people you knew, you know, and it was incredibly painful. And I came home, and growing up, you know, it was the general respect for priests and things like that, just like there was for police officers and all these other kinds of like public servants, if you will. And I was walking through the grocery store, and I was a seminarian, but I had the collar on because I was working at the parish and they asked me to wear it. And I went to the grocery store, I was walking down the aisle, and there was this little girl walks by with her mom and she's like, hi. And I said, hi. And her mom just looked at me and she faced up to me and she spit right in my face. And so the scene in the film where he's where the man stops him and is shaming him and basically saying that his intentions are bad because he's talking to his daughter. You see the look on Brendan Gleeson's face. He played it so perfectly where it's as though all of the joy just gets just drawn out of him to have to suffer that, even though he's a good man. It's very painful. So for me, that movie resonated in that experience. And it also resonated for me as well, because right when I was first ordained, a group of my priest friends, we all went on a trip to Ireland because we'd never been to Ireland. And so we took a vacation. We went and we did a walking trip. And we actually walked through towns unaware. We were unaware of anything over in Ireland, mm-hmm. where horrible abuses had taken place, like at schools and things like this. And we were all in our collars. We decided we're going to go give a witness of the faith. And at that time, there was the brewing hostility, but there was still a latent faith that people had. But the questions that we got, people were curious and hungry about the gospel, but you could also see that they were starting to leave. And then just a couple of years ago, I went back to Ireland with some people, and it was the exact opposite. They would not look at me. They wanted nothing to do with you. So the movie really spoke to me in that way, too, because you can see how Ireland was so instrumental in the evangelization, really, of the world, especially in the United States. And then now it's the exact opposite. It's really a wasteland when it comes to the faith. Every person who realizes that they're suffering and wounded, that are willing to admit it, are the ones who are able to receive what he's giving. It's the ones that don't admit it that push him away. He's a reminder, and I've said this very often, you know, as priests, sometimes you're ministering to people and all of a sudden they disappear off the radar. And you say, where'd they go? What happened? We're like Jiminy Cricket a lot of times. You know, we're the reminder of a conscience that they don't want to have. And so if you show up, it's like, oh, just standoffish. Or if they see you, they want to push you away. The characters that give him tenderness aren't trying to expiate their conscience. They're not trying to push him away.
He's a saint, but he's not a saint. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, he's a holy man, but he's also an imperfect, he's a flawed man.
Well, that's why I think it's a really great image of the priesthood in its reality. And what I was saying in the beginning of our conversation, it doesn't give into sentimentality where the priest is either sappy or he's just saintly with no flaws. There's a great quote of St. Jose Maria Escrivá said, if I was going to write a book on the lives of the saints, I would want to call it The Faults of the Saints. Because so often we read the lives of the saints and they're just like, it's so saccharine. There's you never hear about any of their struggles or any of their difficulties. And this is a movie about a man who's a priest. And he's a man. He goes through the struggles of patience and his own limitations. He's obviously a man who has suffered as well. I mean, he's a widower. And so he's been through that darkness. And, you know, when his daughter attempts suicide, and in the beginning of the film, he picks her up, and he's hurting. But at the same time, there is a kind of disconnect there of some sort. Now, maybe it's some of the Irish coldness, but it's clear that he's struggling with his own emotional situation. And as a priest, being able to watch that, it's like, wow, it is a beautiful thing when people are able to realize your humanity and to give you the space to be able to be fully human, which means striving for sainthood, but at the same time, you're going to fall short at times, right? And that's one of the great difficulties, I would say, one of the great challenges of the priesthood is we are another Christ, but the one thing I'm always very aware of is that I'm not. I mean, like, I am sacramentally, but I fall short every hour on actually being Christ. There's no self-pity or look at me, I'm suffering too. And that's the beauty of the priest, like, yeah, you're human and you go through that. But as a priest, like, you also know that, like, no one ultimately, like, I mean, the people you're serving, they want you to be there for them. You're not going to, you can't look to them for sympathy or anything like that. You know, once in a while, someone's kind and they get it, you know, but, and it's beautiful to see that because he's doing exactly what Jesus did during Holy Week is he's going to all the people that he needs to go to, all the different groups. He's reaching out to them. He's reaching out to the civil authority. He's reaching out to the religious authority. He's reaching out to the poor and, you know, all those things. He's lining it up. He knows it's coming. It reminded me of, I don't know if it was St. Francis de Sales or someone can, maybe you know, there's a famous quote. It said, if you knew you were going to die tomorrow, what would you do differently? And they said, absolutely nothing. Like, I'd keep doing exactly what it is that I'm doing because that's what God's calling me to do. I also think with this particular character, you know, the ones who are doing all the interesting things in, quote unquote, interesting things in the town are, they're really dull. Like, I mean, sin is, and that's something, you know, you can, as a priest, I say, there's just 10 commandments, there's just so many ways you can break them. It really is not. Sin is not interesting, even as a priest. Like when I first became a priest, people were like, oh my gosh, you're going to hear confessions. And I'm like, yeah. I mean, after the first couple of days, you're like, yeah, it really is not that interesting. Sin's not interesting. Mercy is. Forgiveness is, which is the whole point of the film. And forgiveness is underrated. And mercy is underrated. So what makes him a complex character is that he is flawed and human. At the same time, his trajectory is towards the good. And that the flawed hero is fine if their trajectory is towards the good. But when you make it ambiguous, the film really, when you think once he dies, you think this is the most nihilistic film I've ever seen in my life. And then the next scene, the final scene of the film redeems the whole thing. I, to me, think that this film is one of the great evangelical films. Like if you're looking for a film to sit down and watch with friends, you know, The Lord of the Rings is great and all this, like Calvary, you look at people and go, oh, why? Why it's there's so much darkness in it. I think it's better than the saccharine. I mean, it gets to the heart of things. And I remember showing this in the university. I was at a public university and I showed it in class. And here I am, I'm in a collar, I'm teaching the class, and you know, people expect, oh, the priest. You know, I showed some great films of all different religions, but this is the one I wanted for Catholicism because and the people responded to it more than any other film we did. Because it spoke to their heart, like whether it was the particular sins or was the particular darknesses, or it was the fact that a film brought up issues with the church that they had heard before and weren't afraid of, wasn't like watching the priest's reaction that he wasn't scandalized by it or, oh, what do I say? That it was, and then they asked me those questions afterwards and it was the same kind of thing, a great conversation about it. I think what it shows is we're not afraid to run from reality. As a matter of fact, we're going to plunge into the depth, into the very heart of the realest of real, which is this man's suffering or anyone's suffering, and that Christ has an answer to it and that the church is the bride of Christ and she's delivering that answer. I just think it's a brilliant film for that.